quite a while. Actually, I have a little disclaimer that I'm going to put out here. I thought long and hard about doing this and actually put it out on Facebook. So, it's an important clarification about the content of our meetings. And when I say meetings, I mean meetings. We've been doing this. Northwest Georgia has been conducting meetings for over 6 years in this room. We always have and always will continue to present subject matter and speakers that may be deemed controversial or conspiracy theory to some. I have never told anyone how to think or what to do. That's up to you to decide what to do with the information presented. I encourage everyone to do your own research on all our subject matter, and if you have a dissenting view, I will gladly discuss your research and possibly allow you to present it. All I ask is you allow our speakers the courtesy, allow any person, and welcome them for healthy discussion. I have learned that in all we do, the truth is the most important thing that we receive. Even though it can be sometimes painful, truth never changes, and the truth is eternal. Yeah. I've thought about this long and hard for a long time because I ran for county commissioner in Cherokee County, and I was a tinfoil hat, conspiracy theory, field, built. There's a whole bunch of people in this room who have 10-12 hats on.
Yeah.
And everything, so I'm in good company. So I feel good about that. But it's time that everybody, we have to wake up and really understand what our government is doing to us and what they've been doing to us. So because it's out there, we just didn't know about it before. So now's the time. So I'm gonna get switched over to Garth Garland.
I know.
And you move yourself on over here.
I'm going to start as Voter GA is a nonpartisan, nonprofit, all volunteer organization. Most of you know pretty much who we are, but those are the two issues I just mentioned that we are really concerned about. All right, I'm going to start with the state's, arguments. For the voting equipment. And by the way, as y'all know, there was a lawsuit. It was a huge press conference we were down today. And I'm going to tell you all about that. You'll know everything about that before we leave. I'm going to try to hustle through this because it's about 45 minutes. And I presented this yesterday, and we had an hour of questions. And they were all excellent questions. And I don't want to cut anybody short because they deserve a comprehensive answer.
Yeah, and I'm going to jump in and borrow for 1 second. We want to put a little ground rules down. If you have a question, if it's a really quick question or a clarification, it's okay to ask it. If it's anything that takes any detail, I got a microphone up there after Garland gets to the question section, we can do that. And one more thing is, please, if you have a cell phone, put it on vibrate. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jack. And I appreciate all you're doing as well for years and years. We go back a long way. I want to quickly go through the state's arguments. And this basically, their arguments are in regards to the voting machines. We know what's the problem. We test these machines, logic and accuracy testing, extensively. Each machine before an election, there's no big deal. The system has federal and state certifications. KSU, CES, Central Elections Systems, does testing. The machines are not directly connected to the internet, so there's no risk of hacking, really. And there haven't really been any reported problems with these machines since they've been used for 15 years. And there was even one study out there that said they were pretty good. So that's kind of the state's argument. Does that sound like what you've been hearing in the news media, what you've been hearing from Secretary of State's office pretty much? I'm seeing a couple of nods. Okay. So I want to go through and piece by piece see what these, you know, some of these are kind of true and some of these aren't, and we're going to kind of get to the bottom of this really quickly. First one, the counties perform the extensive logic and action testing. That's true. However, the machines are never tested in the election mode that they run in on election day. Never. They've never, ever been tested in 15 years in the mode that they run in on election day. And Merle King has admitted, Merle King is the executive director of the Center for Election Systems, along with his predecessor, Ray Cobb, and Professor Britt Williams, who put the machines in, they have all admitted, either in court or in deposition under oath, that the machines can count differently in test mode versus election mode. Therefore, All of the testing is done is totally negative. It doesn't amount to a hill of beans because the machines are never tested in the vote that they want in an election. The system has federal and state certifications. We're going to go into this a little bit more later on. Let me just say one thing. This complete current system in Georgia has never been certified for safety and accuracy in the systems that we're using right now. You'll see more. We'll talk about that later. By the way, that is a legal requirement. The reason I said I'm machine safe and accurate, that is the legal requirement under OCGA 212.379.2. The machines are not directly connected to the internet, so there's less hacking risk. Well, actually, the machines and cards are prepped from KSU, and I think we've all heard how wide open KSU is lately, exposed to hackers, but if you haven't heard that, I'm going to illustrate that for you in just a minute. There's no reported problems in 15 years of these machines. Actually, there are probably a dozen problems of serious security flaws. We're going to go through some of those in just a minute, as quickly as we can. And what about studies? 10 different studies, state-commissioned and academic studies, have found that these machines that we use, and the same type, have security flaws and gross design and programming errors. I'm going to talk about those. It's a very impressive list. No study in America has ever said that these machines are safe or accurate. I'm sorry, I'm flipping two things here. Y'all keep me honest. I meant to be clicking this clicker. So what's wrong with the current voting method? As everybody has probably heard, it doesn't have an independent voter verified paper ballot audit trail. That's, you know, everybody's saying that now. And I'm getting emails saying, isn't that the same thing you said 15 years ago before they put it in? It's, yes. Lots of people. Michael Lopez has been one of the ones that have sent that. Ricardo has been saying that as well. So what does that mean, though? The voter cannot verify, you cannot verify that vote that you saw on the screen is actually recorded on the card. The elections officials can't audit their results. And there's no recount. You only reprint the previous unverifiable results. So what that means is, the bottom line is, that fraud and errors are now virtually undetectable statewide. I'm going to go quickly through the studies just as fast as I can. Maryland is the best example. Maryland had the exact same machines that we did. They were implemented in 2004. They were removed in 2016. They've gone to optical scan equipment. It's a very identical setup to what we have. They had a study, Governor Bob Ehrlich, you might remember him, had a study commissioned, 26 critical flaws were found in the systems. The Maryland legislature also had their own study from Rather Technologies that found similar concerns. The legislature voted 137-0 to get rid of the machines, and Maryland replaced them within the 10-year lifespan. We're at 15 years. Ohio halted deployment of the machines, the same type, because they found that there were a number of security risks were greater than any other machine that they were using. They did not have statewide of a single machine, which is a good thing. California is another interesting study. California, Secretary of State staff report found DEMO was unable to certify their system. They banned the AccuVoteTS, which is the same machine we use here. They voted unanimously to decertify DEMO 8-0, and then California sued DEMO and won a $2.5 million out-of-court settlement. Maryland also sued them, and I did not put that up there. I'm going to skip that one for the interest of time. A quick couple of studies I wanted to mention from the academic side. In 2004, some of you here might remember Paul Weirich, Free County Office Foundation, in conjunction with voter verified voting, they produced a study that said we were rated last in the country. And this was in 2004, 2 years after we spent $54 million. Last in the country, we were rated on our voting machines on system reliability and recount preparedness. We were rated F minus on national average C plus. No changes have been made to the voting machine since that rating came out. Lots of studies that we don't have time to go into. I'll use the Johns Hopkins study as an example. They said that they found gross design and programming errors in the machines that we're using today, which is an AccuVote TF-R6. In 2006, Princeton University demonstrated how the machines could be hacked in 5 minutes or less. I'm going to show you that video testimony to the United States House in just a minute. No study has ever claimed that the voting machines are accurate, as I mentioned before. All right, internet connections. You've heard that they're not connected to the internet. It's actually correct that they're not directly connected to the internet. However, every machine is exposed to the internet. I'm going to explain how in two different ways. I'm not going to go through this diagram for the interest of time, but I just want to point out one thing in it. And that is up in this corner, Fulton County and Cobb County and other counties, as the Secretary of State, use Clarity for publishing results. Clarity is the a software that's produced by SOE Software out of Tampa, Florida. They're owned by Cito, which is a Spanish-owned firm. So basically, this Spanish-owned firm is publishing their results. That may or may not be a problem, but what they do here is important to know. This is the way that your results get reported, and y'all have probably all gone in and looked at your election results. You have the GEM server. This is operating at your county level. Somebody takes the memory stick. Everybody knows what a memory stick is. You probably have one in your pocket. They take that and they put the results from your GEM server, and they take it over and they put it in a web server. There's good security between these two machines. That's probably good. And then the web server is used to upload to Clarity. The problem comes in when after all the counties that do this take the same memory stick that's just been exposed to the web and they stick it back into the GEM server. So if there was any kind of a hack or something on that, it would go right back in to the county election server and it could modify the results. But that's not the worst thing. The worst thing in the internet world is to have the Center for Election Systems wide open for any kind of hacking and public use. So as you know, if you've probably been reading the what's out there, Merle King, who is the executive director of the Center for Election Systems, was notified on August 28th by a security expert that the system was wide open. And I'm talking about all the voting machine files that are used for elections, the elections database, virtually everything they used to prep for election was wide open to anyone in the entire world.
Including passwords.
Including passwords. Thank you, Ricardo, keeping me honest. The passwords were even wide open. I keep forgetting to mention that. So why is that important? Well, because Center for Election Systems programs, they ship down the database to the county for every election. They ship down the poll book file for every election. And those are come down in the flashcard to the poll books. The poll books then produce the voter access card, that little yellow card that you use that sticks in the machine that could have anything on it that came from the internet and somewhere around the world. In addition, on this side, they provided the GEMS database to the state, which the chief then download. And those servers produce the memory cards that go into the back of the machine. So both the voter access card and the memory cards touch every single machine that's used for an election. And they all came from a server that was wide open for fraud. And after 6 months, the exposure was not closed. Brill was notified on August 28th. In March the 1st, a different security person tried to access it again and found that that vulnerability was still there 6 months later. He contacted a professor at Kennesaw State who contacted the Information Security Office of Kennesaw State, not the CES. They then notified the governor, and they put up a firewall, and they tried to start protecting that server because Merle King could not protect it himself. They took the initiative to try to stop the flood there. So I try to distinguish between KSU and CES. Our problem is not Kennesaw State. Our problem is the Center for Election Systems. All right, certifications. The last certification of a GEM server and a voting machine was in 2007. The system has been patched several times since then. It has not been recertified. And the federal certification doesn't really cover all the components anyway. No state certification exists for all the integrated components that are now in use. And no Secretary of State has ever certified the system for accuracy, which is required or at least specified by law. They simply sign a certificate, but they don't say that, okay, we're certifying for accuracy. That's what the actual law says that they should do, and that's 21.2.379.2. All right, very quickly, you heard that there are no problems with these machines. I want to try to, as quickly as I can, just identify a pile of problems that you've never heard about. And y'all tell me if you have. Of course, you've seen my presentation before, you probably have. In 2002, when these machines were put in, right here in Cobb County, Cobb found 3,256 test votes. They put those in the live election results by accident. Now that's right, 3,256. Now, to Cobb County's credit, they caught the problem. The elections officials caught the problem, and they corrected it before certification. However, the system did not prevent those live results, test results from being added for live election results. Should have. I always like to use the Cobb, since we're in Cobb, a couple of y'all, I'm sure most everybody in the room remembers the infamous Cobb, 2005 Cobb splice, and the 2011. So 2005, just a quick recap. The splice was being defeated by about 4%. And it was, if you remember that night, there were some kinds of problems going on, kissing issues, and then transmission difficulties, and then we had all kinds of delays. And long things come to short. The next morning, they announced that the splice had won by 114 votes. Their problem was that there were 285 blank voted ballots. Nobody knows why there were 285 blank voted ballots in that particular race, because it was the only thing on the ballot. So what they said when we asked the question, well, why was there 285 blank voted ballots? They said, well, apparently the voters came in and they drove to the polls, and then they went in and they stood in line and registered. They got their card, They went over to the machine, they put their card in the machine, and then they decided not to vote. That's what the Center for Election Systems told us. That's what they told us.
Sure.
In 2011, the same thing happened again with different numbers. And except for the fact this time it was decided by 90 votes and there were 95 blank voting ballots. So what's the other interesting thing about 2011 is that the verifiable mail-in vote, which we're going to talk about later, in that election, the SPLOS lost by a 60 to 40% margin. 60 to 40. What's the impact of that? The impact is that in both of these elections, or contests, over $1 billion of taxes were assessed against the people of Cobb County based on blank voting ballots. So that's not a Democrat or Republican issue, blue or red, that's just a tax issue. A few more outside of Cobb. In 2002, we had depositions. We found that the Georgia voting machines were, in fact, patched illegally. A lot of questions about the 2002 election. Certification was never, the JIT servers were never certified. They were patched, and they were never recertified. This was a patch that came down from Bobby Rusnich personally for the full Medicare service. In 2008, let's go back to the test votes again. 947 test votes were loaded into the live election results in Lowndes County. And the elections director certified these. She wasn't quite as sharp as the Cobb County elections people. The Cobb County elections people are smart enough to know to check the poll book totals with the vote totals to see if there's a mismatch. Lowndes County elections director didn't do that. She sent them up certified. Secretary of State's office at that time was Weston Taylor. His office caught that and sent it back and said, that can't be right. Fix it. And she did. But instead of taking a slap on the wrist, she decided that they were in, I say she, but she had some help with the Inspector General's office, which at this time was under Karen Handel. She decided that she was going to blame this on a voting machine technician down in named Laura Gallegos. Mike knows this story very, very well as well. So Laura ended up losing a piece of property, her job. She lost about $3,500 in legal fees. And I spent 100 hours on that case personally to help her get off because she was framed by the Inspector General, who at that time was Sean McGrua. And she was working for, at that time, Karen Handel, who was the Secretary of State of Georgia. Very, very disturbing, one of the worst things I've ever seen. Sean McGrua, if you want to check this out, was eventually subject to impeachment, an impeachment resolution in the Georgia General Assembly. It's still out there. It would be great if you went out and read it. It's called H.R. 1714 in 2010 session. It was filed right here by a former rep from Cobb County, Bobby Franklin. So that's a pretty ugly story, but it gets worse. Maybe it doesn't get worse. It gets about the same. In 2008, the results of the 25,000 Douglas County Election Day votes were taken home on a spreadsheet by an election board member, reviewed by that member in the comfort of his own home. I don't know if he had champagne or he stood by the fireplace. But then he did whatever he wanted to do. He brought these election results back in the spreadsheet the next day, and he ordered the Devo contractor to enter those into the server before the results were published. And two people, the sheriff and the chairman for the county commission, those two people who candidates who thought they had won, lost the next day. Pretty big stink about that. He was never prosecuted for that, and we've raised that issue with Brian Kemp, who could come in new at this time. We raised that with him, but they were never really prosecuted for that. Y'all remember the Alvin Green story? Anybody remember the Alvin Green story from South Carolina?
Yeah.
Michael and McCarter. He somehow won the Democratic U.S. Senate primary in 2010, 60-40 on unverifiable voting equipment. But of course, he never campaigned. We had our own Alvin Green here in Georgia. Her name is Tammy Atkins. Tammy's a divorce lawyer up in Lawrenceville. And she ran for the nonpartisan for the Georgia Supreme Court. You might remember this. It was only about 2008 or somewhere around there. She got 733,000 votes, 35% in a three-way race. But she didn't campaign. She didn't advertise, didn't have a website, didn't take donations, didn't respond to surveys, didn't accept media requests. Or really urban contact data, right? And it was kind of the Alvin Green thing all over here. $733,000. That seems questionable, but I don't know how that could be real. And now I'm going to just kind of fast forward to 2017, the Roswell runoff card. You might remember April 18th. There was a big delay in the votes. The votes kind of looked like they shifted at the last minute. Ossoff had a little over 50%, ended up under. We had a runoff with Ossoff and Handel. So what happened there, there's a big delay, nobody knows what happens. We've done a study on that. Ricardo and I have actually authored a study on that. It's up on the VoterGA website. And it was a Roswell runoff card that Fulton had accidentally entered into the live election results for the 6th District. And the machines didn't catch it. So this is another case. We talked about the machines not catching test votes. Well, now they entered a memory card from another race into the machines. They didn't catch that either.
Wow.
So that's what caused the delay. And the machines couldn't tell what the problem was. They finally fixed it. I think all the results were legitimate. But that's what happened, that's what the delay is. So that's another security flaw in the machines. They can't catch test votes, they can't catch votes from other elections. We call this a critical security flaw because it could impact the results. So that's a little bit of the history I wanted to share with you because you've never actually seen that before and probably haven't heard about most of those. So now I want to play this quick video for you. And Jack, can I just push the button over here? Okay. Jack's going to do this. Let me tell you what's about to take place here. This is Dr. Ed Felton. He also tested out a couple weeks ago here in Atlanta on the other suit. He's testifying before the United States House Administration Committee. This has been probably about 10 years ago. And he's going to show how the machine is hacked, and the machine is using exactly what we use here in Georgia. It's just 3 minutes.
From a security standpoint, what distinguishes computerized voting systems from traditional systems is not the computer. From a security standpoint, what distinguishes computerized voting systems from traditional systems is not that computers are easier to compromise, but that the consequences of compromise can be so much more severe. Tampering with an old-fashioned ballot box can affect a few hundred votes at most, but injecting a virus into a single computerized voting machine can potentially affect an entire election. 2 weeks ago, my colleagues Ari Feldman and Alex Halderman and I released a detailed security analysis of this machine, the Diebold AccuVote TS, which is used in Maryland, Georgia, and elsewhere. My written testimony summarizes the findings of our study. One main finding is that the machines are susceptible to computer viruses that spread from machine to machine and silently transfer votes from one candidate to another. Such a virus requires moderate computer programming skills to construct. Launching it requires access to a single voting machine for as little as 1 minute. I will now demonstrate this using a virus we constructed in our laboratory. We've set up here a simulated election for president between George Washington and Benedict Arnold. It's election day morning, and we just opened the polls. No votes have been cast yet. I'll start by casting the first vote. When I checked in at the polling place at the front desk, the poll workers gave me this voter card, which I now insert into the machine. I press the start button, and I choose to cast my vote for George Washington. The machine asks me to confirm my choice, and I confirm my choice and cast my ballot. The second vote is similar. I insert another voter card. I choose George Washington again, and again I confirm and cast my ballot. The third voter inserts another voter card and votes again for George Washington. The correct vote count in this election, obviously, is George Washington 3, Benedict Arnold 0. Now it's the close of election day. A poll worker inserts a special supervisor card into the machine. Enters a PIN code and tells the machine to end the election and tally the votes. The machine will now print out a paper tape summarizing the ballot count. When I cast my votes earlier, my choice of candidate was recorded in the machine's electronic memory. This record of my vote was invisible to me. I had no way of verifying whether it was recorded correctly or whether it was changed after it was recorded. In this machine, the records were modified by our virus. This paper tape, printed out by the machine, reports the election's result. And it shows George Washington with one vote and Benedict Arnold with two.
So that's a little example of how it's done. It's not easy. I want to move now to the 6th District race and this lawsuit. As y'all know, there was a lawsuit filed, actually it was announced on July 4th, Independence Day. That's 2 points to this lawsuit, is to want to declare independence from unverifiable secret voting in Georgia. And it's also a contest challenge in the 6th District race. So, you might have heard, I don't know if you've read anything about this, but this is probably sour grapes and that sore losers. Well, there's a problem with that. The head organizer of this particular effort is a Republican. Just a Republican out of Colorado, Tom Tancredo. And the plaintiff, there were two plaintiffs who spoke today at the press conference. The other plaintiff happens to be in the room tonight, Ricardo Davis, the chairman of the Constitution Party. Ricardo, thank you.
Thank you.
These don't seem to be wanting Democrats to be, so what's this all about?
I can assure you I'm not part of the existing movement.
So it's a nonpartisan act. And it was a beautiful strategy because they totally defeated that argument. And the press understood it. All the local news channels were here today. You'll see this all over the news when you go home and you'll get it on the comments. So it's a nonpartisan effort. It's not a blue or red issue, as everybody in the room already knows. But the media will now portray that correctly to the audience, and that was incredibly important. You're going to hear this suit had no merit. This is ridiculous. It's far down. I'm going to go through what the suit's all about, and then I'll let you decide whether or not it has merit or not. There are 5 points to this lawsuit. The first one is the Georgia voting system produces results that can't be verified, audited by election officials, verified by the voters, and it can't be recounted for the candidates. We already talked about that. I don't think that's going to be too much of an argument. The second point is that the Cobb County Election Board ignored legal petitions from voters to recanvass the results. I'm sorry, all the counties, not just Cobb. And according to state board, election board regulations, when we get into question and answers a little bit later and discussion, one of the gentleman who filed these petitions is right here tonight. His name is George Balbon. So thank you, George. Another thank you goes out to that. We'll go into a little bit more detail, but let me just summarize this for a second so we can get through. The state board said that the citizens can call for a recanvass, which is kind of like the, it's hard to explain the difference between a recanvass and a recount, but basically the elections officials will check their procedures to make sure that, and redo some of their procedures, make sure that the count is correct. And that's what the citizens asked for, the citizen right here. And it was ignored in three counties with different reasons. So if you see our press release on this, and George, thanks to George, he videotaped it, we are chasing two legal counsels out of the room asking, what's the purpose of a recanvass if you already certified the results? In Cobb, the legal counsel literally told them, advised them to certify anyway, didn't have a choice. And George can talk a little bit more about that later in Canada. Secretary Kemp failed to properly certify the system. We've talked about that. He failed to certify the system as it is running right now. And I think we discussed that a little bit. We talked about Merle King leaving everything wide open. I won't go rehash that again. We've already talked about those. But the bottom line is of this whole suit is that we have a deficient system. It was further compromised by exposure to hacking, lack of proper certification, and refusal to recanvass. That is considered to be misconduct. And if, as a result of this, the results are in doubt. They're undetermined. If there is misconduct that causes results to be in doubt, then there's a legal obligation, if you're a judge or a jury, to throw the election out. So the issue is going to be for the state. They're going to have to prove, with all the evidence I just showed you, that this election was never in doubt. That's going to be a tall order. So if you hear this suit doesn't have merit, this is why it's got merit. We don't know how it's going to play out, but it's definitely a very, very well put together case. I want to just share a few statistics with you. Please feel free to play devil's advocate with me during the Q&A because I'm still looking for some rational explanations for these statistics. And I haven't found it yet. We have 20 election integrity activists in the entire country looking at this, and nobody can explain these statistics I'm going to show you. And we're not finished gathering yet. So we know that Karen Handel won 51.78 to John Ossoff's 48.22. It's been reported different margins. I even saw it on WSB as 53-47, but that's the actual margin of victory. Yes, the problem when you get into looking at the verifiable votes and the mail-in ballots showed that Ossoff won 64-36%. In the provisional votes, it showed that he won, I said by 70-30, the actual margin is 73-27. That's actually a mistake. So you couple those two together and you've got about 11% of the vote. That's a pretty substantial sampling, which could, normally a random audit's only 5%, so this is over double the regular audit. Ossoff won the early voting 51 to 49. Despite, listen to this one carefully, despite having less vote percentage than he did on April 18th when he ran against 17 opponents. And think about this for a second. He's running against 17 opponents in early voting, and he gets 59% of the vote. Now he's running against one opponent 2 months later, and his percentage goes down to vote by 10 points. That seems really strange. If anybody wants to venture a guess as to why that happened, please feel free. Again, I'm looking for answers. So his vote percentage went down against one candidate versus 17 on two different things. And then we started to go to the precinct level. We're still looking at the precinct levels. There were 40 precincts that had a 60-point total swing between mail-in and election. So let's think about this. We're at a precinct level. Everybody knows how small that is. So Ossoff wins the mail-in vote 65 to 35 at this precinct, but loses the election day vote 65 to 35 at the same precinct. And this repeats 40 times. And if you take this number, if you want to go down to 40 points, then that number increases probably to 100. If you want to go down to 20 points, it goes to 150. Almost all of the precincts have this pattern that is very difficult to explain. About 200 of the 209 precincts have this same pattern to a lesser degree. I just picked out the most obvious and strangest. Only five full precincts flip the other way. About 200 flip this way. So the question is, it is more likely that the results are right, or is it more likely that the results are wrong, or do we just not know? So that's a great topic for discussion, and again, feel free to be devil's advocate and challenge me on that. Again, I'm looking for some answers myself. I'm going to leave. Yes, there's one more question back here.
The percentages are one thing, but the vote totals are a lot different. The vote totals were tremendously different between April and June.
Correct. There was a vote increase. There was a tremendous vote increase. That's correct. So I'm going to go to the final slides because I promised, Jack made me promise that I was going to get some jaw-dropping information here. All right, so I'm going to get down to the jaw-dropping information. This ranks almost up there with the SB40 studies, but it's getting close. So let's conclude before we get to the Q&A. Let's just recap what we talked about. Machines were designed without a voter verified. We know that they accepted invalid memory cards. They're not more secure to distinguish them. I talked about the test election mode switch that negates all the test results. It's actually not a switch, it's a saving on the computer. So all the test results can be negated and automatically negated every time you guess an election. The machines were designed to accept negative votes. There were 16,084 negative votes entered into a machine of this type in the 2000 election in Florida. The elections officials caught the error and then corrected it, but the machine allowed negative votes. So there's never been a negative vote cast in the history of American elections. Why would the machines be programmed to allow negative votes? But it doesn't end there. The machines also, if you get into it, allow fractional votes. The votes are recorded in the database in fractions. No one in the history of American elections has ever cast a fractional vote. So why would the machines be programmed to allow fractional votes.
Before you said, I can't remember what it was, when you said like something traced back to Ukraine.
Yes. Let's say that question for the Q&A. So the question here is, you have to start asking a question that comes to my mind as a 40-year IT person. Were the machines designed that way intentionally or not? Were they designed for the express purpose of committing fraud? Could anybody have been this stupid when they designed the system? I mean, I don't know of anybody. Ricardo and I are in business, we've been doing this for years. I don't know how that happened. They were built by Global Election Systems, acquired by Diebold. I'm going to show you the excerpt of an SEC filing from Diebold in 2001. I'm going to highlight a gentleman named Jeffrey Dean. He was a senior programmer, designer, largest shareholder, as you can see from that excerpt, that SEC filing. This is Jeffrey Dean's prison record, where he was convicted on 3 counts. He was charged with 23 counts of fraud and embezzlement. Convicted on at least 3, I'm not sure, I don't have all the documents at home. So the key designer of these machines was in prison for fraud and embezzlement. And I'm personally convinced that they, based on my experience, probably were designed for this express purpose. So with that, I'm going to leave it open to Q&A, but I want to start with Michael. So the first question, because I want to mention there was something important. Yeah, Michael, you want to grab that mic?
Sure.
I want to, Michael needs to tell you a quick little story about how secret the election system is, particularly in Cobb County. And so, Michael, quickly go ahead and share your story about trying to see the balance as a candidate in your race for a sure. District.
Thank you, Garland. Garland and I have been working on this issue for 13 years. In 2012, I ran for Congress in the 11th District. Obviously, I lost to Phil Gingrey, the incumbent. But I wanted to see what kind of correlation we had of the votes with the hard copy ballots, absentee ballots, hard copy ballots that were mailed in, contrasted with the ratio of voting machine ballots. So I asked the Cobb County Board of Elections if I could review those elections, and I was going to have Garland in that review, where I wouldn't touch them. They would just be slid across the table. My attorney and I would be there so we could count. And then we could see what kind of comparison that we had, whether I won by 51% or whether the deviation, how much there was a deviation, if any, from the voting machine electronic results. I was denied that. My attorney and I then filed a lawsuit against the Board of Elections, Cobb County Elections, so I could see, we could review those ballots, not to touch them, not to take them from the premise, just have them slid across the table. We went to court, Cobb County Superior Court. The ruling was that there was no compelling reason for me to see those ballots, even though I was a candidate. Hard to believe, but that was it. So the judge said, there is no state law that permits you to review those ballots. And if you want to review those ballots, there has to be a state law put in place that allows you access to review those ballots. I thought, well, this is going to be an easy process. I've got some friends at the Capitol. Went to Charles Gregory, explained it to him. He was a new representative at the time. We went to Legislative Council. Legislative Council drafted the law. It wasn't a law. It wasn't a long document, very short. And I thought, this is going to be easy. And I talked to some of my friends who were state legislature, and I said, by the way, do you know that you cannot see those hard copy ballots? Whether you're the governor or Senator Isaacson, you have no ability to review that. And they were all astounded. So I thought this would be an easy thing to get the state legislature to pass that so they and I could see the ballots, the hard copy ballots. Not to remove again, not to even touch, just to have them split across the table. Charles introduced that or tried to introduce it. I don't think it even came out of committee. It was squashed. Think about that. Who runs the state legislature? Okay? You know, nobody stepped forward to say, I'm going to squash it. But it didn't come to a vote. It didn't get out of committee. And Charles was defeated at the next election. Shame on him for trying to do something good. The citizens in the state of Alabama. And I can't say enough for all the good work, hard work that Garland has done on behalf of the citizens of Georgia. And we thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Yeah. Just a couple of other words of thank you. Michael has done more to make the Republican establishment more of this issue than anybody in the state. So, Michael, I appreciate that. Also, Michael reminded me that he was the one that introduced me to Marilyn Wise, who's behind this lawsuit. So that's a double thank you, Michael. Okay, so if y'all have a question, come on down. I want to start with your question here. We've got a mic here, but you had asked about the Clarity and Cytle, the Spanish home firm that owns SOE software. I do not know who owns Cytle.
I had heard something. Yeah, who's the microphone?
Yeah, if you got a question, come down, get on the mic, because this is being recorded.
I remember during the presidential election, there was something to do with voting machines or, you know, some sort of ballot counting verification that don't worry, it's going to a Spanish company. And then you find out the Spanish company was owned by George Soros, and I'm wondering if that's the same company, because he loves to get involved in other countries' elections.
Yeah, I can't answer that question, because I do not know who owns Cytle, unfortunately.
I think what it is the Spanish company takes the tallies of the votes and puts them into a presentation. They don't actually count the votes.
Right, and that's true. They don't. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
They don't actually count the votes. They just publish the results.
They publish
this is a good point.
Presentation.
They just exactly the votes are counted here at the Jim Zern. And then they're taken and then sent up there to publish. So that is absolutely correct that they don't actually count the votes.
I think
it was an SOE. SOE, yeah, it's SOE software.
Something
else. Yeah, SOE software is based in Tampa, Florida. It's owned by Cytle, which is a Spanish home firm. I do not know who owns Cytle, though. So it's a good question. You've got a question, and I'll repeat it, and we'll go to Pat. If you don't want to go to the mic, I'll just repeat your question.
You are a part of work. In other words, what you're saying tonight is stay using the machine, metal in your vote.
Yeah, it's a great question. So what's the best way to protect your vote? Should you mail it out? That's what I did. We put out a risk survey on how to vote with the least amount of risk. And on top, the highest risk is to vote in early voting because the memory cards are left open for the entire duration of your voting. That's the highest risk. Next highest is regular voting on election day. Third lowest would be to mail in the vote. You can apply for an absentee ballot. It's a little cumbersome, but you can vote from home, get the ballot sent to you, mail it back in. I personally got that application and I hand delivered my ballot to the North Adams in Fulton County in the last time, just to make sure it was counted. let's go to Pat first, and then I think Pat.
Okay. The machines are what, 15 years old?
Exactly, Pat.
Okay. So the time they've expended their time basically.
Yeah, the machines are ten-year life, and we're at 15 years.
Okay. So the bottom line is, for the next, since we're losing the Secretary of State is moving on, we will have a new Secretary of State, hopefully someone we all like. But the bottom line is,
doesn't matter whether you like them, it's hope they're fair.
What would you, amen, what would you recommend to the incoming Secretary of State to do?
Okay, in regards to the voting machines,
yes.
What to do? The first thing I would say, we don't really need to have a massive evaluation. We already know there's a problem. The general consensus from the election experts around the country, and also the most cost-effective that the legislators, all legislators I've talked to, like, is to go to optical scan equipment, the bubble charts, paper ballot. There's very little disagreement about that. It's very cost-effective. It's recountable. It solves all the problems. The machines can record both the image of the ballot, and they can record the actual vote count. You can calculate it. You can cross-check it both ways. You've got the paper to check the electronic count. You've got the electronic count to check the paper. So the interesting part about that, that's exactly what Maryland did, and it doesn't cost that much. So it only would cost us about $30 million to implement this. Just to give you an example, Maryland implemented it for $20 million. We spent $54 million on these machines back in 2002. There was no reason to spend that kind of money. But it was a very well-connected technology, which is another story. But that would be the solution would be optical scan, paper ballot. There's almost no argument about it. So all the way back in the back, I can't see you.
Hi, I'm Katrina Bryson.
Hey, Katrina.
Hi. I'm really interested to know about Kennesaw State and their relationship with the election. Like, how did that contract come about? Is it like for the rest? Like, how many years is that? Are there other schools that can be, you know, that's, I'm just curious.
Yeah, okay. I don't have a full answer, Katrina, but here's what I can tell you. It's definitely not a competitive bid, for sure. Professor Britt Williams, who was a Cal State State professor, conducted the evaluation of the machines. Okay. It was an automatic thing that Kathy Cox basically had picked them and decided that they were going to be the support team. And what the rationale that Kathy Cox had at that time, I do not know. But it's been a wired contract, to use a term that Mike Larry used on that. And it goes, it's been in place since creation now of the machines here in Georgia.
Okay.
And they are reviewing that contract. Brian Kemp says he's reviewing it. I doubt seriously that people want to change it. Although he's very angry at Earl King right now for leaving the system wide open and putting on the flag. Because legally, Brian Kemp is responsible for Earl King's actions in the last year. Phil had a question.
Not so much a question as a
comment. Sure. Go ahead, Phil. No, by the way, Phil, I want to compliment Phil for a minute. Phil was the one who turned me on to the silo thing to begin with, because you probably don't remember. But Phil said, hey, did you see this? I don't think it's a big deal. But as I got to looking at it, Phil, it was a big deal. So, thank you, Phil.
Yeah.
See, you're valuable anyway. But that's another story.
Well, Bill and I met a guy. He's passed away now. He owned the mailbox, et cetera, store there in Boston Road.
Right.
And I keep me honest in the story, I'm trying to remember the details, but he worked for a competitor company
to Diebold.
And made a bid for the same time that the Diebold's making their bid. And he was told their system had verifiable trail. And he was told, we don't want that kind of system here in Georgia. Is that what he told us? Yeah,
that's exactly right.
And so their system was verifiable, and he was told by the powers that be, we do not want that system in Georgia.
And their system was less money.
Yeah, that's the other piece.
Yeah, great, great. Quick comment on that. That was probably Aiken Gibbs out of Nashville, Tennessee. He died in a wreck up there somewhere. There, and that was a verifiable voting system, it's just as Phil was saying. There was also another one called TrueVote out of New Jersey. There were two verifiable voting systems available for purchase when these machines were bought in 2002. But they were not the well-connected technology.
Yeah, who represents Diebold? A former Secretary of State.
Okay, so now I'm going to have to tell this story. So Pat, no, it's a great story, you've got to know this. As Pat's pointing out, Louis Massey was the former Secretary of State. I've got to tell this story. So Louis was well-connected. Louis became, Kathy Cox worked for Louis. Kathy Cox then became Secretary of State. Louis became a lobbyist. Louis got the Diebold contract, and I was told just yesterday that that was a wired contract, even though it looked like it was a home evaluation. So Louis basically profited, and Kathy Cox obviously had an allegiance to her former boss, so that deal went to Diebold. Now, I have to tell the rest of the story. Louis Massey then decides to form a partnership with Bruce Bowers. And this is where, this is an education for everybody. We want to understand how lobbyists work down at the Capitol. Bruce Bowers is the son of a former popular Attorney General, Michael Bowers. Louis Massey, former popular Democratic Secretary of State, they form a partnership. It's a lobbying partnership, and it goes, it controls both sides of the political spectrum. So in 2006, when Kathy Cox lost her bid for governor, primarily because of these machines, she lost the Democratic primary to Martin Taylor, then Ken Handel comes in, 2006, they just shift their lobbying from Louis Massey to Bruce Bowers. The Bowers family funded Karen Handel to the tune of about $25,000, which we had found. And Karen, who wrote the best report I've ever seen written about these machines in 2006, told us she was going to set up a commission. I was a huge supporter of hers. She was going to fix the problem. Totally reversed herself and said that we had the most secure elections in the country. And we found out she had taken $25,000 from the family. And that's just a drop in the iceberg, typically iceberg, a drop in the bucket, because they, you know, her partner, one of their partners, Rob Sims, was, has been a key fundraiser for her and all of her runs for Senate and for governorship as well as congressional race.
Why don't you go ahead and tell them who the third partner is of the company now, too?
The third partner? Well, you're gonna, thank you. And I didn't know this. So I have to give credit to Dave Rettenhouse for doing this research. He was the one that educated me. Dave said, wait a minute, the third partner is a guy named John Watson. And it was. It was Massey Watson Bowers.
Oh, John Watson.
John Watson was the one who's now the chair of the Republican Party of Georgia.
Does that make you feel all warm and fuzzy now? That party's going to just march right down the right road, right?
Okay, Debbie's got a question. I think Bill's got a question.
Well, actually, can I make a statement and tell about what we met with Brian Kemp?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so there's, so Bill was there, Field was there, Sue, Jan Barton, Michael, Garland. First meeting, we were told to go and talk to the governor. The governor refused to meet us, even though we knew the governor very well. Worked on his campaign, he dissed us. We went to his
attorney. His attorney said, oh my gosh, no, you know, this is a no-brainer. We are going to fix these machines. So when we went back to him to find him again, weeks and weeks, we kept trying to find him. He kept us hiding behind the door in his office every time. We never could meet with him. So the next time we go back to Brian Kemp with a new presentation, we have a PowerPoint, we present this to him. He puts one of his men around each one of us sitting around the table, and we presented to him where Jan had found with this one of these TrueVote guys that we had, there was $8 million of money available if you have a funds for the state of Georgia for voting. So we presented that we, for $3.8 million, we could put verifiable voting on every machine in the state. And he became very angry. Yes, he was very, very angry. I have this recording. Jack has this recording if anybody's interested in this. We have the audio recording of this. That made me become a believer that we had options there and they were declined.
Thank you, David.
Mrs. Garland's been working this for hours.
He was pissed off that we found
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
He was upset that we found the money to be able to fix the machine.
Oh, that's right, because that's what he said. We have that money spent on something else. We're going to spend it on something else. And then that was the year we went with the cycle.
They did the same thing to us on the poll books. We said, spend the money on verifiable voting and spend it on the poll books.
Yes.
Yeah. That was before we went there.
You brought up Kathy Cox a while ago. And when she decided on these machines, it was state law that they had to be verifiable. And so, to keep her ass out of prison, they had to change the law.
Yeah, great question, Bill. This is another great story. This is why we went off an hour yesterday, because these are stories you've got to know about. So that's exactly what happened. Kathy Cox signed a contract on May 4th, 2002, to buy $54 million of Diebold equipment, which at the time did not have a voter verified paper audit trail, and that's what the law required. So the way that went down, and this was all Jack Hill, who's still the Appropriations Committee chair in the Senate, although I heard his job was offered to somebody else. But that's another story. He's got a bill called SB 213. It's got a requirement for an independent audit trail. Kathy Cox took that requirement out of the request for a proposal, which was recommended by her 21st Century Voting Commission. And they knew that they were not going to be able to buy machines that had an independent audit trail of each vote cast, because the well-connected machines didn't have it. And as I think Phil pointed out, someone, that the ones that did have a verifiable paper trail, they were not well-connected. So they were going to buy this. So Jack Hill introduces a new bill in 2002. It's called SB 414. And that bill removed the audit trail. So they thought they were hot dog, we're ready to go. Only problem was, Governor didn't sign that bill before Kathy Cox signed the Diebold contract. Kathy Cox signed the contract to buy $54 million worth of illegal equipment on May the 4th. And that bill did not go into law until the governor signed it on May the 9th.
Wow.
We raised this issue. We raised this issue with the Secretary of State, and we raised it in our legal battle that went to the Georgia Supreme Court. The Attorney General's Office of the State of Georgia said, it's kind of a moot point now. It's already been done.
Garland, we know that Matthew Bowers was the lobbying organization for the Diebold voting machines. But I also understand that they were the sales agents for the voting machines as well. So the question is, are they still getting a commission off each of the machines, plus the software, plus the service, plus any other ancillary services that those machines need?
Great point. And maybe we could do an open records request to see the history of what the Secretary of State's office has been paying Matthew Bowers over the years. Just to clarify, and that's a great point, Michael. So Louis Matthew was the lobbyist at the time of the purchase. He then forms the partnership with Matthew Bowers. However, as Michael's pointing out, there's ongoing maintenance and all sorts of money and contracts and stuff.
Software
upgrades, all kinds of stuff. That Matthew Bowers, I'm sure, is still getting a commission on. as a result of the initial sale by Lewis Matthey, which is probably why it's called Matthey Bowers and not Bowers Matthey. Hey, John.
Matthew Bowers? Lewis Matthey.
Secretary of State in 1994, 1998.
John. Just a question about the optical scan ballots versus the electronic voting machine.
Yes.
I know you mentioned Maryland has gone back to optical scan.
Yes.
What does the picture look like nationally in terms of optical scan versus electronic?
Yeah. So everybody is divesting themselves of the DRAs right now. Statewide, Maryland reeled off a few states for me.
Louisiana, South Carolina, Delaware, New Jersey have a DRA's machine without paper trail, and the training is always
statewide. Yeah, and there's already a slew of them that have gone away from Colorado, Florida, North Carolina. And I can't remember all of them, Josh, but I can get that information.
Have they all gone to scanning?
Yes, they've all gone. Thank you for asking that. Every state that I know of that has moved off of DREs, which is direct recording electronic devices, have gone to optical scan. There is no effort that I'm seeing is to try to go to verifiable DREs, which there are some out there, but there's a lot of issues with how to make them work properly. So the general consensus is it's so much cheaper, just go back to the optical scan paper ballot. Okay, I saw another question back and I'll come back. Yes?
I have a question. Have you tried to go to the media and try to publicize this? And gotten nowhere.
Right. Where did the media stand on this? Okay, so we got good press coverage when we filed the suit back in 2006. A lot of coverage didn't die down because the state wasn't willing to do anything. And we kind of backed off. You know, we tried to, as Debbie said, we tried to work with Brian Kemp when he first got elected. Brian said, I didn't want on this issue, which was true. He didn't. We said, it's your job, though, to have a good question. The media has now picked up on this. When you get home, you're going to see massive coverage of this, a lot of good coverage of this lawsuit that was filed today. And now the citizens are not going to let it die. We have national support. 20 computer scientists have urged in a letter to Brian Kemp to verify voting. I have 20 election integrity acts saying that these results are suspect and that it was probably tampering. So now the news media, the local news media, is forced to cover this because we're getting great national exposure. We're getting articles and radio shows from California and New York and Illinois. So the pressure is now coming down on Georgia to start telling the truth. That's going to be great.
On one of your earlier slides, pictorial of the entire process. The optical scanners, the lit optical scanners, would those be at each polling place that are increasing?
Yes, that's a good question.
So my question then becomes, we still have a lot of network to go through before the actual votes are tallied statewide or countywide, even that leave us some vulnerabilities. I'm just playing devil's advocate, but one of the things I thought about is if the voting machines, if we had the current voting machines updated with printed in them with multi-part paper, that the voter could actually have a copy of it, put in their pocket, take home, put the drop in the ballot box, and another one could be wound up inside the machine. Whether that's all doable or not, but it seems like it might give a more verifiable way of voting.
Yeah, so that's a couple of great points that I can comment on. If we had the voting machines that we have today actually have a paper roll in them that could be used for a voter verified paper ballot. We proposed to Georgia 10 years ago,
papers.
Let us write the software and give it to the state to make these paper machines produce battery. And they said, Debo said, no, sorry, you can't modify our software. So they shot that down. But that's a great question. And then the other point about the optical scan is that the reason optical scan is so much cheaper is because you only have to put one optical scanner in the precinct. You might have to have a ballot marker for visually impaired. But if you got one optical scanner in the precinct instead of 20 voting machines, imagine the cost savings in that. That's one of the biggest things. Now, normally in most counties, they take the cards and they hand deliver them to the county, so therefore you don't have to worry about them going over the network. However, in Fulton, they're still using upload points, three upload points, North, South, Annex, and Roswell City Hall. So those are going up through a phone line. They're talking about getting rid of those and hand delivering them back down to the county, which probably wouldn't be that bad.
Does that make way too much
sense? Bill, you have another question? Oh, yeah, you're good. That's great. Any other questions before we wrap up? Oh, yes.
I just have a statement.
This is one of our plaintiffs here.
Yes. And don't hate me because I'm a patriot and I love this country and I want everyone's vote to count no matter what it is. And I think it's very important that we get the voting machines fixed. I've worked for IBM in the compliance department for years. My husband has worked for IBM for 34 years. And voting machines are computers. And they can be infected, just like you would take a needle and stab it in and infect something else. It can be transferred from machine to machine. This is very serious. And I'm so glad to see you all here. And thank you so much for coming. And I'd love to see that we all care about our country and we need to make sure that something is done to fix these computers. Thank you.
This is William Barber-Dibbs. Where are your Cobb County plaintiffs for this matter? Of course. And Ricardo is also on the suit, as you know. So thank you, Lauren Wayne. Thank you.
I just wanted to say, Brian Kemp has stonewalled. You know, in his office that day when he got upset when we found the money, he said that the voting machines are verifiable or there's nothing wrong with them. They've been certified when they haven't been. And now, and he's responsible for Merrill Marks up at Kennesaw State with the CES and him leaving it wide open.
Merrill King.
Merrill
King. I thought you were talking about Merrill Marks.
No, Merrill King. He's responsible for him. So if you guys win or if you come out at least with a tie, I think Brian Kemp's run for the governorship is over.
I'll go one step further on that. I think Brian Kemp's run for the governorship is already over. Win or lose.
Okay.
It's
over with me.
Oh, I heard that story and now I'm not voting
Kemp. Let me go to Pat and then Laura's got something. Okay. We have to probably wrap up.
As you know, 2 years ago, I was still work for a company that makes voting machines for the blind. All the Democrats. No, just kidding.
that was not a
conference.
I forgot deaf and dumb.
But the point was, when I was doing this, what people don't realize is only 8% of the blind read Braille, but they can dial a phone quicker than you and I ever dreamed of. And so the way if you've noticed at the precincts, they have phones there for the blind. And anyhow, I was selling this company to Georgia, as well as I've done Florida and South Carolina. Well, why I was thinking, as a veteran, I was thinking, why couldn't this be used for the GIs overseas? And talk to Josh and Schaefer and some of the other legislators, and they said, that sounds like a great idea, Pat, and it's already being used around the country for the blind. So why not, let's do it? So I went to Brian, and Brian says, well, I don't know about that, Pat. That sounds like that could be a problem. I want you to go out and talk to Merle King. So, most arrogant SOB I've ever met in my life.
Wow.
So I met with him about 4 or 5 times. Well, then I went back down to Brian, and he said, well, I'm not sure. So then I went to Schaefer and to the House and asked them to put a vote out and to put legislation in that the Secretary of State's office would has a year to study this and come back to them on why not doing this for the GIs over in Europe, you know, and then around the world. And so the Senate passed it. Brian got word of it, and he went to the Speaker, and they killed him. And so I lost my bill.
And we are going to need, we are going to need something for the blind.
That phone system gives a paper trail down at the Secretary of State's office or the Election Board office, whatever. You know, some states it doesn't come under the Secretary of State.
I'm going to give Laura one more thing. I'm going to give her the last word tonight because we have to wrap up. And then
somebody gave me this question. It says, where are the Russians all fit in
this? I wonder who did that.
It's by the way, since you brought that up, it's a diversionary time. We don't know who did
it. Well, Kim brought it up.
It was Kim.
One thing though, I wanted to sue Kim because he wouldn't let me do it. And the worst part is the lawyer I went to was Mike Bowers.
We have a good lawyer.
I wanted to say thank you. Did you have anything else, Laura?
No.
Okay. I just want to say thank you. So tonight we have a mixture of people across the entire political spectrum. And I think it's always interesting. This is the second time we've had this. I presented this. And it's something that everybody agrees on. It doesn't matter whether you're conservative, progressive, Democrat, Republican, independent, libertarian, Constitution Party, blah, blah, blah. It's great to have people who agree, we all agree on this issue. And I just want to say thank you.
I just wanted to recommend one other thing. If you want to research, there's a movie called Hacking Democracy by HBO.
Yes.
It was produced by Democrats about two George Bush elections, but it's a really good movie.
Yes.
Hacking
Democracy, produced by Russ Michaels out of UK. I'm talking with him quite often. Absolute. If you want to see something about these machines, Bill, thanks for bringing it out. Thanks for being here. I really enjoyed being here. Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks everybody for coming out.